First example, we're going to find the limit, L. Then we're going to use the epsilon-delta definition to prove that the limit actually is L. And here's our first example, that linear function y is equal to 3x plus 8. We're going to find the limit as x approaches negative 2 of 3x plus 8, and then prove that that answer that we get actually is the limit. Well, we have just a line with a y-intercept of 8 and a slope of 3. We can look at the graph and easily see that the limit as x approaches negative 2 looks like it's going to be positive 2. We can do this numerically by simply plugging in negative 2 and getting again that that limit is equal to 2. But again, stressing the idea that a function's limit is not necessarily the same thing as the function's value. If this was a piecewise function, maybe you could plug this value of c into the function and get an answer that really wasn't the limit, or maybe the function's existing at c when the limit doesn't exist, or maybe there was a hole, I'm pointing to where the graph used to be, where the function doesn't exist but the limit does. So we want to prove that the limit actually is equal to 2. Now, how the heck are we going to do that? With all of the delta epsilon proofs that we're going to work on, these are the steps that you're going to want to do. You want to take the absolute value of f of x minus L, and which is less than, we're going to be assuming initially that it's less than epsilon, and rewrite it to match the notation of 0 is less than the absolute value of x minus c minus delta. And again, this being greater than 0 is just the emphasis that x and c are not the same value x is approaching c. Really, you're going to see me kind of emphasizing the right-hand side here about the x minus c being less than delta. And when we get this f of x minus l expression to match this x minus c notation, that is going to allow us to create a direct relationship between epsilon and delta. In that case, you know, in this line here, you're going to see a relationship between epsilon and delta that, because this is just simply a linear function, you can kind of see that relationship to some degree. You will at the end of the example, right there inside the linear function. Then, to actually do the proof, see, there's no way that step one can be the proof, because we're trying to prove that, we're going to find delta greater than zero such that f of x minus l, the absolute value of that, is less than epsilon whenever, basically, the absolute value of x minus c, I don't know why I'm saying basically, but is greater than 0, but really we're emphasizing that the absolute value of x minus c is less than delta. So as long as we give an x that is within delta of c, then we're going to get a function value that is within epsilon of the limit right here. That distance between the function's value and the limit is less than the epsilon that you gave me, that I gave you a delta that matched, and then we get this function's value that's within that epsilon. Getting the whole infinitely close idea for limits. Okay, so we're trying to prove this part. We're trying to prove that whenever the absolute value of x minus c is less than delta, that the absolute value of f of x minus l is less than epsilon. We're trying to prove that. So in step one, where you see me start this work and I'm saying f of x minus l, the absolute value that is less than epsilon, I'm using an assumption in the beginning of this work that I'm trying to prove. So you've got to know that step one is not part of the proof. It's scratch work just to develop this relationship between delta and epsilon. Then we actually start the proof by saying we're going to let the absolute value of x minus c be less than that delta that we get, sort of like an educated guess from step one, and prove that the absolute value of f x minus l is less than epsilon. And with the finish of that statement, that the absolute value of f of x minus l is less than epsilon, then that is created our, you know, that's finished our proof. That's saying, again, one more time, you give me an arbitrary distance, an arbitrarily small distance from the limit, and I will give you a matching delta such that if we pick an x that's closer to c than delta, then I'll move even closer to the limit than, you know, this initial arbitrary value, arbitrarily small value of epsilon. So let's get that proof done. Okay, so we are going to, we're going to, given the fact that epsilon is greater than zero, we're going to start off with that absolute value of f of x minus l is less than epsilon. Well, our function is 3x plus 8. The limit that we found when we let x approach negative 2 was equal to 2. Oh, and I think what I'm going to do as well, this is the goal that we want to do, but let's put some notation from the actual problem so it's not quite so generic. The limit that we did find was, again, equal to 2, and the c that we're concerned about in this particular problem is, and I'm not sure if I'm going to fit this in here, is negative 2. So, you know, I'm basically going to try and get this expression, this f of x minus l expression, to look like the absolute value of x plus 2. And if I do, then I will be able to, you know, I mean, it's an absolute value, it's an absolute value, it's less than and less than an epsilon and delta, so I'll get that direct relationship. Well, 8 minus 2 is 6, so we have the absolute value of 3x plus 6 is less than epsilon. We can take a 2 out of that absolute value. The absolute value of 3x plus 6 is the same as the absolute value of 2 times the absolute value of x plus, wait, I'm not taking a 2 out, I'm taking a 3. I'm thinking of the answers. So let's just change that. We're factoring a 3 out. There we go. So the absolute value of 3x plus 6 is equal to the absolute value of 3 times the absolute value of x plus 2. And of course, the absolute value of 3 is just 3. So we're going to move that 3 over to the other side and get the absolute value of x plus 2 is less than epsilon over 3. Well, so I've changed my f of x minus l expression to have that matching x plus 2 on the inside. So if x plus 2, the absolute value of x plus 2 is less than delta, and the absolute value of x plus 2 is less than epsilon plus over 3, then I can say that we're going to let, delta, is equal to epsilon, there we go, over 3. And that really shouldn't be a shocking revelation that delta is going to be 1/3 basically of epsilon, because the slope of this line is 3 for every 1 unit along the x-axis. And delta is a horizontal move along the x-axis from C. That the function, the slope is 3, so for every 1 unit on the x-axis you move, the vertical distance is going to change by a multiple of 3. So if you want to put it in terms of delta, delta is the horizontal distance along the number line is 1/3 of epsilon. Now, you're not always going to be able to see that because a lot of your problem, many of your problems are not going to be linear functions, but there's that relationship. Now, what you want to do is this is our scratch work. This is that direct relationship between delta and epsilon that we were talking about. So now, just want to make sure I don't write this the wrong way. You want to actually start the proof by writing this. For every delta greater than 0, let delta equal epsilon over 3. And 0 is less than the absolute value of x minus negative 2, which is less than delta. Or just the idea that we're going to be letting the x approach that negative 2. So you can write x minus negative 2 or just simply x plus 2. Now, again, our goal is to prove that f of x minus l is less than epsilon when you have this relationship that delta is 1/3, equal to 1/3 of epsilon. So we're going to start off with, so we have f of x, which is going to be, I'm pausing because I realize I'm not going to have enough room to write all this, f of x is 3x plus 8 minus our limit, which is equal to 2. And I'm not going to write that that's less than epsilon. That's what I'm trying to prove. So let's see what we got here. We have 8 minus 2, which is going to be, of course, 6. And actually, I want to pause here for a second. Let's say that this expression is our absolute value of f of x minus L. I want to just have that written there so we have it to reference at the end of our proof. So the absolute value of x minus L is equal to the absolute value of 3x plus 8 minus 2. 8 minus 2, of course, is equal to 6. We can take the, now this is equal to, now we have our 3x plus 6. We're going to take out our factor of 3 and get x plus 2. And this f of x minus L is still equal to that expression of 3x plus 2. But now, see, for every delta greater than 0, let delta equal epsilon over 3, and the assumption that we're going to be picking x's, x minus 2 is less than delta. So I can bring this in here and now say that this expression is less than 3 times delta, because it says right there, and absolute value of x plus 2 basically is less than delta. Well, delta we have set up to be equal to 3x, or equal to e over 3. So now that is, now this inequality is going to be in reference to our absolute value of f of x minus L. So that is going to be less than 3. My next problem is I have 3's and E's together. 3 times delta, which we set, we're setting equal to epsilon over 3. And of course, you know, multiplying by 3 and dividing by 3 are going to cancel out. And we have that when those cancel out, we have less than epsilon. So we have proven that the absolute value of f of x minus L is less than epsilon when we have this direct relationship between delta, which is equal to 1/3 epsilon, that direct relationship we got from our initial scratch work, getting our f of x minus L expression to match that x minus C expression. And that's the end of our first proof. So that's saying that as long as you give me an arbitrarily small distance of epsilon, I can give you a delta, which is 1/3 the value of epsilon. And then when you give me, when I come up with an x that's inside that delta, which is 1/3 epsilon, I can give you an x, go to the function, and get a value from that function that is within the distance of epsilon to the limit. And that is the end of our first example.